Hello and welcome to this webinar coming to you from the Parliamentary Library of the Victorian Parliament. I'm Bill Bainbridge, I'm one of the communications advisors here at the Parliament. And before we begin, I'd like to acknowledge the Wurundjeri people, the traditional owners of the land from which we're broadcasting. We pay our respects to them, their elders past, present and emerging. I'm joined today by three of the people who keep this library ticking. We have Chief Librarian Carolyn McVean, Terry Aquino, who's the Coordinator, Information Access and Management, and Sarah Edwards, the Heritage Coordinator. Welcome to you all.
Thank you, Bill.
And we'd really like to hear from you. If you have questions for any of our panellists or if you just have comments, then put them in the chat section on our Facebook page and we'll try to get to those as soon as we possibly can. But first, if I can start with you, Sarah. So the library is 170 years, or yesterday turned 170 years old. It's been in this location for 160 years. Mm-hmm. Can you take us back to that? We're talking about Gold Rush era Melbourne. Take us back to the origins of this library.
So let's go back, Bill, to 1851, which is a time when the Parliament was being established in Melbourne. It was due to the Gold Rush, and it was there was such a great big inundation of population that it was a Parliament was definitely necessary to start to establish law for all of Victoria and New South Wales at that time as well. So it was interesting to look at. We hired out a space at St Patrick's Hall, which is now where near where the in Bourke Street, which is now near where the Law Institute is, and the library was essentially a way of attracting the right sort of people to the Parliament. So people who were learned, who were wealthy, they were landowners, they were mainly from England. So it was a way of attracting those people.
So books were like a magnet.
They were indeed. The library was called a gentleman's library, or referred to as a gentleman's library. So it was extremely eclectic in terms of the nature of its collection and content. So it included not just legislation, but it included things like archaeology, Greek mythology, poetry.
Taxidermy. Sail making.
And yeah, a huge range of things that were just so much broader than the things that you would imagine were necessary for running a parliament.
And that original committee that formed, that included some of the key people who people would know from the history of Victoria.
Yes, absolutely. People like Redmond Barry, John Pascoe Faulkner. Redmond Barry was sort of on a lot of committees he established as well, the State Library, the Law Library and University of Melbourne Library. And Joe Pascoe Faulkner was responsible for publishing the first newspaper in Melbourne. And we do have a copy of his first handwritten newspaper.
And that's here in the collection?
It is indeed.
And would that be one of the most rare items that you have?
Yes. Yes.
And so, Carolyn, when you think about, you know, you're in charge of this institution, which has this very long history. Do you think back to all of your predecessors over the past 170 years when you're thinking about, you know, what is the sort of meaning and the value of this library?
I don't think much about them, actually, to be honest, but certainly I have read about them and their histories and their backgrounds, and fascinating. I am librarian number 19 and the fourth female to be in here after 170 years. So we're getting there, but we've got about 100 another 170 years to go before.
It's a rare club, 19 in 170 years.
It is indeedy. And the first female librarian, which I'd like to mention, the first female parliamentary librarian was Josephine McGovern. And she was here she was here much longer in the 60s, but she became the parliamentary librarian in 1970, and she stayed here till 1986, until her retirement. But she was the first female parliamentary librarian here, but also in Australia. So I think of her because they're the shoes I want to follow.
Mm. Mm. And so, Terry, thinking about as an institution. What are some of the ways that this would have changed over the last 170 years? What are the things that are done differently now to when the library was in its earliest stages?
Yeah, well, when the library was established at that time, of course, a lot of communication was done using pen and ink. People were writing letters to each other. The amount of print materials that were around were fairly limited. So the way that people researched information was using books. They might have used pamphlets, flyers, treaties. There would have been all different kinds of information, but not much produced locally at that time. We were purchasing books from overseas. The first library was started with a collection of books that was obtained from England. And as Sarah's mentioned, that was the gentleman's library. That was the tradition at the time. And of course, all members of Parliament at that time were men. So it was quite the thing to do.
And so that you have there, that's the very first catalogue?
Yes, it is. This book is a complete catalogue of all of the books that were in the first edition, I guess, of the Parliamentary Library. So it basically contains a listing by subject areas of importance to Victorians, and then within that subject listing is an alphabetical listing by author of the books that they'd written. So the librarian at the time would have had to have a very good, thorough understanding of the books that were on the shelves to be able to know where to locate them and pull them off for the members.
There's no Google to help them out.
No, it was memory, relying on your memory and relying on what was in the book. So you would have become very familiar with that catalogue.
And the early MPs in those days, how would they have used the library?
They would have come to the librarian as a starting point because, of course, knowing what was on the shelves, you needed an intermediary. And so they would have requested information. If the librarian had something that was available, they could pull it off the shelves and give them the book. If they didn't have that information, they might need to write a letter and ask a colleague elsewhere for it. Or they might need to write to a supplier overseas in England or other countries to try and find that information. It was quite different. It was quite slow because you're writing the letter by hand. You're posting it in the mail. The mail is being put in a bag and taken by ship. So everything just went a lot slower. I think bureaucracies often get knocked by the amount of time it takes for anything to happen. Well, part of that was because it used to take a lot of time.
Yes.
Another part of the library too was this place is what I would class as sort of sacred to members. They could come in here and have quiet conversations with each other and know that nothing ever gets past their lips, pretty much. So that's something that we still do these days, of course, is that when we do the research, is that we have members come in, they'll ask for answers to questions, particularly on sitting days when they'll rush in and say, I've got to speak on this bill or whatever. And all the information that we prepare for the member is totally confidential and impartial. Mm. And they're some of the things that still carries this place in great pride.
And something that wouldn't have changed very much in the entire history of the library, that function.
Not while I'm here.
I wonder if we can talk a little bit about the architecture. So this building, the library building, was actually built after the two chambers. And so how was it connected architecturally to the two chambers? Sarah?
So it runs to the back of the chambers and you can enter into a corridor that then enables you to get into the library from the chambers. I guess architecturally the library itself is absolutely beautiful, and as you can see, and you may not be aware, this is the original architecture of the building. It was designed by architect Peter Kerr, and he not only designed the architecture, a classical Roman style, he also designed the beautiful furniture that we have in the library, dedicated to each of the spaces. We're currently broadcasting from the North Library, so the tables we're sitting at here were designed by the architect. Terry, you were talking about the librarian and how he might service the members, at the time being male. So there's a decagonal table which is in the central library, again designed by Peter Kerr, with 10, it's decagonal, so 10-sided with 10 winged lions. And they, it was carved from blackwood from the sourced from the Dandenong Ranges. So where possible, Peter Kerr wanted to bring in the natural resources from Victoria. Mm. So it essentially represents Victoria as well. There's a beautiful chandelier that hung above the decagonal table, and that is made from 3,678 pieces of Belgian crystal. You can imagine what a nightmare it was to clean the chandelier. It had originally hung in the council chamber, of which there were three. When the Parliament House was changed from coal gas to electricity in the 1880s, the three chandeliers were brought down and put into boxes and kept under the front steps of Parliament House. In the 1920s, it was deemed they were found and sourced from under the steps, and it was deemed that one of those beautiful chandeliers would hang in the central library. So it has had pride of place up until very recently. With significant building works, it's had to be dismantled and put into safe storage, and we can't wait to get it back.
Right.
That's not the only thing that took pride of place, though.
Yep.
All found under the front steps. So Clarence, our resident lion, also was found under the front steps and lives in here, the North Library. And Sarah, beautiful story, please share.
So the lion was a competition by, again, Peter Kerr. He was calling for artists to put in something that would flank the front steps of Parliament House. And the importance of having a lion, or two lions actually, to be on the front steps, cast in bronze, magnificent, glorious things. So this plaster model of a quarter size of the actual lions that were to be at the front steps was chosen by Peter Kerr, and the artist was John McKennell, a well-known civic artist in Melbourne working in the 1880s. And so it was selected to be cast. It never happened. And again, it was Clarence was relegated to the front, under the front steps of Parliament House, where so many other treasures have found their fate.
And so there would have been two enormous copper lions at either end of the stairs entering Parliament. And this one that we have here in the library is just a model of what was proposed.
Yes, it's just a model, but it is equally beautiful and evocative of what could be.
And it was they didn't go ahead because of the 1880s recession, is that?
Yes, with the land bust and then the consequent depression. And actually, the Parliament itself could afford to cast to spend the money, but they just thought it wasn't a good look, and it was Deakin who was Prime Minister at the time, so he just felt it wasn't a good thing to move forward with.
And Deakin, of course, is a key figure here. The libraries here is named after him. Why was Deakin so important to this library, Caroline?
He was important because when they were choosing a place to have the Parliament.
Federal Parliament.
The Federal Parliament in 1901. Deakin didn't want to leave his library behind, his library. And he loved his books and he loved libraries so much that this place was his, he just loved it so much that he just didn't want to leave it behind. So Parliament came here and this library kept going for 27 years as the Federal Parliamentary Library.
So the Federal Parliament sat here from Federation until the Parliament House in Canberra was opened
And they had the two librarians here too. So they had the federal parliamentary librarian who was the Victorian parliamentary librarian. His name was Wadsworth, and he ended up being the parliamentary librarian for the Commonwealth.
And so I wonder if you can talk, Terry, a little bit more about some of the things that might have changed over the years, some of the things that would have been done that we've moved away from, that we've updated.
Well, I think essentially the services that the library provides have remained much the same, providing impartial, accurate, timely information to members of parliament on subjects that they're interested in. What has changed is the delivery method. So in the past, members of parliament would have to walk in to the library to request information or write a letter. Now we take walk-ins, telephone calls, emails, text messages. We can get requests for information in any number of ways. We also deliver information in quite different ways now, too. So the requests that we get, they might be for a printed report, it might be for a parliamentary paper, it might be for a newspaper clipping or for radio or television broadcast. So we are able to, with our teams, we capture any information that's relevant to Parliament, members of Parliament, the State of Victoria, Victorian government projects, major projects like infrastructure. And we keep that information and then we can provide it to members in whatever format they require in the time frame that they set.
And so this, I mean, you showed us earlier that the first catalogue where everything's put into one book, the library then would have moved on to a card catalogue system that people would be familiar with from libraries past.
Some people may be familiar with it, some people may not. So for those who aren't, in the 1800s, a person named Melville Dewey came up with the Dewey Decimal System of Library Classification, which is a big mouthful, but it was a way of numerically coding each book so that you could arrange it on a bookshelf in a logical order and retrieve it. So it just made searching and finding information that much easier rather than having to say, well, which subject is it in and who's the author? You could actually look for that information. It would be printed in three forms. So you'd have a set of cards that were organized by author, a set of cards that were organized by title, and a set that were organized by subject. And for a librarian, that made it really easy to be able to find exactly the information they wanted. Now, I'll continue. Of course, all of those cards have been digitized. That information, author, title, subject, is in your library catalog. So when you go and you search a library catalog, you're actually searching through the work that has been done by generations and generations and generations of librarians.
And we did have a question about that on Facebook. Deb on Facebook asked when that occurred. When the library transitioned from cards to a computer system?
I don't have a specific date for that, but we can find that out, certainly.
I wasn't in this place when we transitioned. I was actually at Melbourne University.
Right.
And we had the card catalogue and the online catalogue side by side. And anything new that came in at the time would automatically go into the online catalogue, and any older material was still in the card catalogue. And eventually that moved over. Now, I might be showing that I started my library career when I was a baby, but that was 1979.
Right.
I was definitely a baby.
Yeah. So we can assume it would have gone on here roughly around
a little
the same
bit similar,
time, I'm sure,
yeah,
most likely.
Probably, you know, within, it wouldn't be a very big time gap at all.
Yeah, it's within.
It'd be the 80s, absolutely.
Yeah, Michael Mamouni, one of our staff members, recalls a time during that transition. In fact, Daisy Rosato. Yeah.
And they're still here.
They're still here.
I love this place.
And so, Sarah, you talked about the newspaper from John Pascoe Faulkner. What are some of the other really rare and valuable books that are in the collection?
Okay, I'll just put my my glove on just for the show and tell. So our earliest or our oldest book in the collection is by an author called Palladius, and it's approximately 500 years old. Mm. It's covered in vellum, which is animal skin. It's on agriculture, and I'll just keep it up for a moment. It's on. It has 13 chapters. So the first chapter is all about just agriculture in general, and then the other 12 chapters are what you do in each month of the year in terms of sowing and reaping your rewards. It represents an interesting time in history. So it's sort of essentially published. It's Venetian and it's published at the time of the Renaissance. So the same sort of people who were working at that time were Leonardo da Vinci, Michelangelo, Raphael. And the interesting thing for me about that is it was a time of looking out, and it was less about religious control and more about looking to the land and looking to nature in order to manage your world. It was a whole new way of thinking about.
Would that book have been in the collection because it was believed to have a practical application? I mean, were people looking to that to see, okay, you know, what can we plant in Victoria? What crops would be successful?
Bill, I would have to say that this is a book of curiosity.
Right.
So it's printed in Italian, so you would have to, or Venetian specifically, so you would have to know how to read that language. Again, it's an attractor for a learned gentleman, and it would be something you could be proud to be able to read, but it would have no practical application given Australian conditions are so vastly different to those in Europe and specifically in Venice.
Mm. Mm. And we also have some of Gould's bird books.
Yes, John Gould's Birds of Australia, and he published those in 8 volumes. It's a fascinating collection, and now just really a curiosity. They are considered rare books, but at the time they were not rare. They were definitely something that was enabled John Gould to get people to subscribe to the book, and he could share the unique ornithology or birds of Australia with people in Europe, in England. It was a really interesting time. So that was again in the 1800s.
Mm. Yeah. And is there, as a librarian, is there a favourite book that you have?
I can't tell you that.
Yeah. It's too.
I'd have to share information with you.
So. I think the book that I like is by William Strutt, Victoria the Golden. This book contains sketches by William Strutt of the colonial Victoria as well. He's got sketches of just looking at what colonial life was like. So on the riverfront, transport by river, say, or pastoral scenes, or looking at the, he copied the expedition.
Yes, of Burke and Wills.
Burke and Wills expedition. So you actually, this is a first-hand account of what people looked like, how they moved, how they
and lived. How rare is that book?
It's exceptionally rare. It's one of a kind. He, as an artist, he did sketches, and so it's not. It is reproduced, and you can. It is available digitally, but it's definitely a one of a kind. We have Tommy.
We've got two of Strutt's famous pieces.
And yes,
Victoria the Golden's one of the famous one of a kind, but it was one of 12, I believe. But we don't know how many are left, maybe one other. But it's one of a kind here. And there's the sketchbook of the Burke and Wills expedition, and that's just rare as. And we do have that here with the Victoria the Golden. And we know Strutt's artwork. If you go into the State Library of Victoria, you'll see some of his magnificent pieces there.
Yeah.
Very.
His paintings. These the sketchbooks are sketches specifically. Mm. And we have Tommy Bent to thank, one of the premiers who was sort of less favoured at the time, but we have him to thank for, as treasurer, going to London and meeting up with William Strutt, who'd gone back from Melbourne to London and brought the book back to Melbourne. He purchased the book from William Strutt and brought it back with him.
Yeah. And it's not just books, of course. You've brought some other things in from the collection.
I have.
What are some of the other...
I guess I just wanted to show the sort of eclectic nature of the various things in the collection. So we've got... this is the medals that I'm going to show you are from the Graham Berry collection. He was the 11th Premier of Victoria. So this is the St George Cross. And excuse me, I just have to be careful in handling this. It's beautiful... medal that he would have worn, and he was gifted that by the Queen. We also have the Légion d'Honneur, which is a French medal, and we have a very tiny version of that as well, which he could have more readily worn on his lapel. And then we have, just as a contrast, a tin of sardines from Portugal from the 1950s, which was recently excavated from or found behind a wall, again related to the significant building works that are happening at Parliament House at the moment. And while in terms of monetary value, these three objects that I've shown you are significantly worlds apart, in terms of their cultural value, and they all hold equal significance and importance.
It's they're storytelling objects, and I just want to make a point that the sardines are no longer in that can. but certainly it tells a story about this place, and I think that's why we keep all the different collections here, is because everything here has a story, and we're unearthing all those stories.
And Diana on Facebook has a question on this theme. She's asking... what sort of conservation conditions are there for rare books and objects?
Sarah, do you
want to... we work with an external conservation organisation at Melbourne University, the Grimwade Centre, so we don't assume that we have that knowledge. It's a very specialist area, and we engage, when necessary, conservators to help us with the important work of preserving the democratic history of Victoria.
Having said that, though, the collections that we have, and along with William Strutt's Victoria the Golden, will lie the tin of sardines, sans sardines. all this material, all these objects, our artworks, we've got a lot of paintings, we look after that, all our pieces, the catalogues and all that, live in a secure spot. It's climate controlled and limited access to people.
So exceptionally limited.
They have to get permission and be escorted in there to see anything. So,
The library is a living institution. It's a functioning part of the Parliament. It's not just here for archiving rare books. Yeah. It's very much a dynamic contemporary institution. What are some of the things that you do in order to support the work of the Parliament?
Well, apart from the members, we have seminars, which used to be in here all the time. They've gone to webinars, and I'm sure people have seen those webinars before, and they're available on the website when they're ready, so people can revisit those webinars. But we have other programs. We have fellowships here, we have intern programs. And when the Parliament's open, we have tours in here as well. And when we do reopen, we will have part of the tour through this place, because it is a magnificent piece of architecture. Mm. It's a magnificent place to work. It's a fun place to work at times. Quite often, it's fun. But we also, we're here for the members who serve their constituents. So more and more, as we can get the material digitised and out into the public's space, that's what we're aiming for. So people can see what this place, what the library, but also Parliament, what it represents to people.
So how, on a sort of day-to-day basis, an MP comes into the library, what sort of things would they be coming to the library and asking you for help with?
I'm going to flick that one to Terry.
Terry?
Anything and everything, really. As you can imagine, members of Parliament come from every single community across Victoria, and their constituents have every range of needs or questions. And so they often will bring those questions to us and ask us for assistance with them. They also come to us to do research on specific topics. Like every other Victorian, every MP has their own history, their own areas of subject-specific interests, certain level of knowledge about things. So we can't assume that every member of Parliament is across every single topic that may be raised in a bill that's presented to Parliament. So we do a lot of work. We look at the bills that are coming up, and we write research papers in advance of the bill being presented or in conjunction with it, and make those available to members and to the public on the website. We might do just a very brief paper if it's a small topic, or we might do a longer, larger piece of research. We also,
those briefings and those papers that you write for upcoming bills, they're especially important for some of the minor parties or the independents
who
perhaps don't have the resources of the public service behind them.
Yes, exactly. So we find they may come to us with a request about the media, newspaper articles in particular. They may want to see which stories have been written on specific topics. I think their members are often concerned with sort of the basics of their within their constituencies. So things like transportation, infrastructure projects, healthcare, education. We have resources on all of these things going back several decades, at least, if not longer, and we're able to put together packages of information for the members to use.
We've had Joe was asked on Facebook if there's a publicly accessible catalogue. The catalogue itself isn't publicly accessible, but there are lots of ways. I mean, you mentioned the research papers being published on the website. What are some of the other ways that the public can use the resources here?
I'll answer that one. Well, we have anything that we can put out to the public, we do put out to the public. So, but any information that we prepare for members, of course, totally confidential and impartial, as I mentioned. But we are a library of last resort, but we also want to get more of the history.
The public.
Yeah.
For the public,
sorry.
first call for members of Parliament.
Oops. I do plan to be here another 170 years, but might be short-lived. But certainly we have got a lot of heritage items that we want to get out into the public space, because really we're the custodians of these wonderful pieces. So.
Yeah, I guess in addition to that, Carolyn, these objects represent the democratic history of Victoria. So it's really... It's all Victorians. This collection belongs to all Victorians. And that's, you're right, Carolyn, you know, getting it out there in any way we can. There's another way as well, which the public can access aspects of the collection. If you're a researcher, or if you're writing a publication, or if you have a specific interest, maybe related to a family member that was a former member of Parliament, you can write to the light, you can email us, and we can look at your inquiry, and we can either arrange post-COVID, a visit to the space, or we can help you with your research inquiry in whatever way we can help.
Mm-hmm. So we had a question from Deb about how many librarians are employed by the library, but it's not just librarians, is it? You've got a range of skills.
We've got about 20 people in the unit, including myself, and there's we've got three subunits. So we've got research and publications, we've got the heritage space, and we've got the information access and management area. Now, we've got researchers and librarians in the research and publications. Librarians in your area, pretty much, Terry, because that really is the crux of the library service. And then in heritage, Sarah's got heritage experts. So a range of skills. We all do a range of work, and really, I think that's how we love sharing the love, isn't it? That we work across the three units and we skill up each other. We share the information we find when we can. And but we also have different ideas of getting out there to the public.
And we did have a request from Denise. She wanted to see inside the catalogue. Now, I'm not sure, it might flare a little bit on the camera, but...
No pictures in that one.
it is just sort of the lines of text. But this is, you said that was printed on rag paper.
Yeah, so the book is leather bound, and the paper itself, prior to widespread use of pulped trees to make paper, what we know as paper, people had to use whatever they could, and oftentimes that would be rags. They would take the rags and, through a special process, create paper out of them. And the thing about paper that's made from rag is it's much more durable than tree fiber or plant fiber, I guess. So. I don't know if you want to speak to that, Sarah.
Perfect. Yeah, that's perfectly adequate, I think, for...
So that's one of the reasons why those are so well-preserved.
They don't deteriorate. Rag paper doesn't deteriorate as quickly as tree pulp paper. It's just a different composition. And by being leather-bound, this book has been hand-sewn together, so the pages themselves have been stitched. Bound in leather, which has been treated and then printed, and it will last a very, very long time. Mm. That's compared with a paperback novel.
So Deb on Facebook wants to know if there's ever any collaboration between this library and the Supreme Court Library, given their significance to Victoria. Do you collaborate, or do researchers perhaps?
We collaborate with all the libraries around us, the other parliamentary libraries. We collaborate with the Public Record Office, state libraries, national libraries. If we don't, it's funny you were saying about the memories. If we didn't have it, we know where to find it, and that's one of the roles of a librarian is, you know, phone a friend.
And the relevance of libraries in the age of the internet, when we can get everything on Google, do libraries still need to exist?
I'm giving you a dirty
I can see.
Yeah, look, it's all very well having information on the internet, but the thing is, with what we do as professionals, we mentioned the research. We have research that is peer-reviewed. It has to be quality research, because that research, we have members relying on that in Parliament and in the chambers. So we have to be correct. So that's where librarians and our researchers come together. You can read whatever you like on Google or the internet or whatever, but unless it can be verified and substantiated, I'd be checking. So not everything's on the internet.
So another question from Kyle, how many different languages other than English are included in books in the library? Terry, is there a collection of non-English books, or there wouldn't be so many?
Most of the books are in English.
Yeah.
I will say that some of the books in the rare book collection are in other languages, but we do have a sprinkling throughout the collection, but it's not. Not very large.
Got a couple of dictionaries in other languages.
Yeah.
And do they get a workout?
There's a French English dictionary just on the in the Central Library at the moment that someone wanted. So, the collection of materials is relevant for today's use.
Yeah.
We would have once upon a time had all these books in other languages, such as the Venetian book over there. But really, it's not a place for this library anymore, but certainly other libraries would have that material.
Now, we did mention that probably post-lockdown, when things get back to normal, this library will be accessible on the tours. Is there a time frame for that? We don't really know when that might happen at this stage for people who want to come.
We hope, we don't know.
Not this year.
Not this year, but hopefully next year.
Hopefully in the coming year.
Tours will be available again. And you get a lot of school groups through
a lot of school groups.
How do school kids react to
the school groups love this. And actually when we were in lockdown, we'd have the school incursions. There used to be excursions when the kids would come in. But we did a lot of the school incursions in this library. And they wanted to know how whether Harry Potter actually came from here. And the answer is yes. Yeah.
Well, not just Harry Potter, but there's rumoured to be a ghost as well. Anybody ever encountered the library ghost?
I've said I have, but I've heard about it. One of our staff members, when she'd come in early in the mornings, she would be spooked by this ghost. She'd feel the air of the ghost over her shoulder, and it freaked her out a few times, and she said she was telling me about it. And anyway, she said every time she comes in now, she says hello first.
It's interesting because I've encountered the ghost, not firsthand, but I've heard a book crash onto the floor and I thought it was someone falling off a ladder. But in fact, when I went up to the Deakin Gallery, I could see that it was a book that had flung itself off the shelf, or we do believe it was the ghost that had assisted.
And what's the ghost's favoured reading material? What was the ghost's favourite?
It was laws that hadn't been approved.
Right, laws proposed yet
proposed,
never passed.
Yes, never passed.
Right.
And it was so
possibly a disgruntled member, the ghost of a disgruntled member.
No, we think it was the second. Yeah, we think the second librarian. What was his name, Carolyn?
That was James Smith.
Yeah, James.
So Smith. James Smith is rumoured to be still here and still overseeing the. And you talked about it being also a fun place to work.
Always.
What are some of the things the team gets up to?
Up and down ladders, opening and closing blinds, having a chat to Clarence.
A little snooze.
Yeah, having a snooze, you know, when no one's looking. Just general.
Tongue in cheek, that is. Look, you've got to enjoy where you work. It's an absolute pleasure to walk into this place every day and just see how much history there is, but also to see how current we remain. And 170 years, I mean, it's nothing compared to libraries in general, which have been around for over 2,000 years, but certainly I hope to be around for the next 170.
Carolyn, I hear that you want to be the next library ghost.
I do indeed, yes.
And the library is likely to be here for another 170 years. Do you think that its essential function
absolutely
will be just the same?
It's like anything. Look, things go in cycles. Legislation, infrastructure, all those issues, everything goes in cycles. Librarians have been at the forefront of moving with technology anyway. And it's just another example. You know, if you think about library catalogues, they were around. Metadata were around with the library catalogue in the 70s.
And the questions facing the state are in many ways the same. You said infrastructure.
Yeah, transport, all of those things. And the thing is, as more and more information is out in, you know, cyber space, the more important it is that you know to get the right information at the right time. And I think that's where libraries and you know, community libraries as well. They're special places for people, and this one in particular is a special place for members, past and present and future.
Well, thank you. On that note, we are out of time, so I'll have to leave it there. So Carolyn, Terry, Sarah, thank you so much for taking part and talking to us about the library.
It's been an absolute pleasure.
Thank you to all of the people who watched, and especially to those who put questions in on Facebook. I hope we managed to answer them all, but if not, perhaps we can do this again in another 170 years. Thank you very much again to our Auslan interpreters and to the broadcast team who did so much to put this event together. From all of us here, though, at the Victorian Parliament, thanks so much for tuning in.